Tri-State Worship Center, our aim isn't to be the best church in the community, but to be the best church for the community. We're here to encourage the saints, help the hurting, and embrace all people. At Tri-State Worship Center, there's a ministry for everyone. So if you're looking for a place to grow and serve others, or just need some additional encouragement, we've got you covered. We like to keep it casual and very friendly. You'll barely make it through the door without being greeted with a smile and a handshake, or even a hug. Don't worry about a dress code. We don't have one. The important thing is that you come. So come in what you have, and we'll go from there. It's our vision to be a beacon, a light, a celebration of hope, a hope that we can only find in Jesus. We only ask one thing. You've tried it your way. Why not give his way a try? We'll see you at church.
Welcome to Tri-State Worship Center. My name's Abby, and I have some announcements to share with you this morning. If you're a guest with us today, thanks for being here. The best way to get connected at TSWC is to text WELCOME to 740-224-8694. We also have a small token of our appreciation for you being here. Regular attenders, listen up. Please text here to the same number, and once again, thanks for being here. TSWC live streams the 11 a.m. service. Last month we had over 4,000 views, in part because of your help. So get your phones out, go to TSWC's Facebook page, and like and share the live stream. Such an easy way to help get the word out. Men's Bible study is tonight at 6 p.m., looking at seven challenges men face. Come and join the journey to becoming a godly man. Wednesday night we have classes for all ages, beginning at 7 p.m. Mike Stevens is teaching a series in the adult class on Bible-based finances. Here's an opportunity for the whole family to continue the journey to discipleship. Thursday is a night full of ministry at TSWC. Ladies Bible Study, Glow Girls, and Royal Rangers all beginning at 6 p.m. Don't miss out. Saturday at 7 p.m. is our weekly prayer time. Here's an opportunity to come and pray for our community, church, and world. Stay for 15 minutes or an hour, but let's pray. Our shoebox rummage sale is Saturday, May 4th from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. It will be held at the STEM school. Come and buy some stuff, eat some food, or rent a space. See Natalie Sheets to rent a space. Let's support the shoebox ministry. TSWC VBS begins July 10th. We are starting the planning, and we need volunteers. Also, there is a link you can pre-register your children on the TSWC Facebook page. Please see Eric or Elena Wall for more details. Graduation Sunday is June 2nd, honoring all high school and college grads. Please send Holly 2 to 3 pictures of your graduate and make plans to join us as we honor our TSWC grads. At TSWC, we believe in being good managers of what God has entrusted to us, including our finances. We encourage you to give today through one of these ways. The box is on the walls. Text to give at 740-370-4342. On Facebook, you can hit Shop Now. At our website, tswc.org, or you can swipe your card at the kiosk in the foyer. Stay connected with us throughout the week online at tswc.org and on Facebook and Instagram at Tri-State Worship Center. Philippians 4:4 says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice." Will you rejoice with us this morning? Thanks again for sharing time with us this morning. Here's Pastor Terry to greet you and open with prayer.
Good morning. Let's all stand. You're glad to be in the house of the Lord? Say, uh-huh. I guess we need to pray for Abby. I guess she probably got a headache this morning, right? I mean, she was skipping through the park yesterday, so excited about our announcement video, that she fell and hit her head. Seriously hit her head and ended up in the hospital. But she's okay, but she's not here. So let's pray for Abby this morning. We're going to put our prayer list up on the screen as well as on our Facebook pages. One name I need to add is Matthew Viers. Some of you know Matthew. He texted me early this morning, asked for us to remember him in prayer. So if you remember Matthew Viers, as well as all those names that are on our prayer list, probably the most names I've ever had on our prayer list, but we serve a big God. Special need this morning. Let me just see a hand real quick. You believe he's able? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for allowing us to come into your house for such a time as this. I pray that as we've gathered here, that we will just make the choice to rejoice and to lift our voices in praise and in worship to you. Lift our countenance towards heaven and magnify the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I pray that as we do that, inhabit the praises of your people, supply every need. Those that are represented on our prayer list, as well as those represented by an uplifted hand, we know that you are able to do things that are far more than we could ever ask or think of you to do. So let us hear some reports of victory of how you've touched your people. We pray this morning you'll bless those who give in the offering. Again, multiply that offering for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Lord, our request is simple this morning. Let everything that we do point somebody to Jesus Christ. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for that. For it is in Christ's name that we pray. Someone shout amen. Amen. Turn around and tell somebody you're glad to see him in church.
Come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord. That saved a wretch like me.
Amen. 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 Are you thankful for His grace? Amen. Before we dismiss the children, you guys can go take your place over there somewhere. What's up, buddy? Yeah. I'm going to ask Stephanie Jordan. Where's she at? Oh. Sorry, I didn't know you was praying. She's just a praying woman. Stephanie Jordan, share with us something that took place last week that is very exciting. I want these kids to be able to hear it. After she's done, Dave, if you'll come.
Last week we were back there in Holland, which if anybody's around her knows, she's really not great at being quiet. She's working on it. She is four, but she was asking what they were doing, and I said, well, we're praying, you know, they're giving salvation if somebody wants to give their heart to Jesus. And she says, Mommy, I want to give my heart to Jesus. And I said, okay. So I get Steve, and we sit down, and we talk with her to make sure she's, you know, she understands. And she prayed. And then all day she was like, I'm so happy that I gave my heart to Jesus.
All right, kids, I got one message for you. You are important. There's nothing more important than you. You might think, well, that vehicle in my driveway is important, not more than you. That home that you stay in, it's not more important than you. You might think, mom or dad's job, I think that might be more important than me. That's a lie. There's nothing more important than you. Whenever it comes to God, He is involved with you and totally always has His eyes on you and with you. Guys, I woke up this morning, I tried to play some kickball last night. I proved to be a total embarrassment on the kickball field last night. But I woke up and it was like I got hit by a truck. I just feel I'm getting older. Guys, what's a good sign someone's getting older?
Hair.
What about the hair?
Gray. They get taller.
He said beard with a D at the end.
They get a cane. They sleep longer.
That's good. Those are really good. One of my best friends this morning said, David, you're 43 years old. You're not a teenager anymore. Had another friend stop by the house this morning as he's coming down the driveway. He's rolling down the window, and he said, look at all that gray in your beard. He's just yelling at me. Getting older. Here's another thing about getting older. You guys mentioned hair, gray hair. Your hair starts falling out a little bit more than it grows. Now, here's a scientific truth for you guys. Your all's hair is falling out right now, but your hair grows so fast you don't even notice it. Over so many months, all of your eyelashes will fall out, but you don't notice because their new ones are always growing back in. But the number of hairs on your head, hundreds of thousands of them, the number changes constantly. Because you're always losing hair, and it's always growing back. Just as you get older, you just lose a little bit more than you grow. Luke chapter 12, verse 7. This is how important you are to God. It says that God knows the number of hairs on your head. And it changes constantly. This morning is going to be different than what it is this evening. But God is so involved with who you are because you are so important to God. Even the smallest minute things and the number of hairs on your head, God knows the number. And it's not that He counts it and He leaves. He counts it and He recounts it and He recounts it. It's that God knows because God is involved in your life. God has an amazing plan for you. You are important. There's nothing more important than you. All throughout this week, your Sunday school teachers and Eric and Elena, they could have been watching movies or hanging out watching TV, but they put that aside to study and to pray for you, to fast, to prepare for Sunday because you are important. And for these people out here, all the old people out here, you are important to us. There's nothing more important than you. God loves you so much. Church, let's pray for our kids. Lord, You're an amazing Father. You're a God that is totally involved in our kids' lives. You don't leave them or walk off or lose them in the store or leave them out in the car. You are always with them. You love them so much, and they're so important to you. Lord, these kids, just implant that on their heart and in their mind, that they are never separated from you. Nobody can remove them from you. Nobody can push you away. They are yours. And Lord, we honor that we are never out here without you. Lord, we love you. We thank you for our children. We ask that they be blessed. And Eric and Elena, our Sunday school teachers, our parents, those who are feeding our children the gospel of Jesus, Lord, bless them and bless that time that we have together in that teaching. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Big round of applause. Big round of applause for our kids.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, David. Amen. Man, according to that, I must be really old. Taller, no hair, gray. I don't even know how I'm standing here. Old and decrepit that I am. Hey, good morning. Look at your neighbor right now and just say, you look awesome. Some of you are like, nope, I ain't telling them. You rebellious bunch of... Hey, last week, Chris McBeath spoke to us, our missionary from Nicaragua. He spoke to us about Job and all that Job had gone through, all of the tough times that Job went through. And he summarized it in Job chapter 42, verse 5, where Job says, my ears had heard of you, but now I see you. Now my eyes see you. And really what that meant was is that before all of the trial and tribulation that Job went through, he had heard about God. You know, like people say, trust in the Lord, have faith, believe God's going to see you through. But then he went through it and saw God bring him out the other side. And so before he had heard about God, but once he got through everything, he saw God. You know, what was the difference? Well, the difference was prior to the tribulation, he had only heard. After the tribulation, now he begins to see. You see, some would say, well, I'll believe it when I see it. But the truth is, sometimes you have to believe it to see it. Sometimes you just have to believe to see. But when your eyes are opened, I think there's something that happens to us. It happened with Holland last week. I think she had heard about Jesus probably every day of her life. But all of a sudden last week, when she prayed that prayer, I believe she saw Jesus. And I believe her life has been different ever since. And I think that that moment lasts for us as well. I think there's a moment in the journey of every believer where this begins to make sense. I think there's a moment in the life of every believer that's on this Christian journey where we connect with God in a supernatural way that tells us this is not just about duty and obligation anymore. This is now about serving Christ enthusiastically. This is about coming to church and joining with the community of faith and believing in God and doing it in a way that changes my life, not just something that I do to check off the checklist. It gets to the point where instead of saying, well, it's Sunday and I have to go to church, it's Sunday and I get to go to church. I don't know about you, but I could not wait to be with you this morning. I couldn't wait. I got here early. I get here early every Sunday. But as I walked in the door, I thought, how exciting it's going to be just to be with the community of faith, to worship our God, and then to have a time in His Word. And I believe there's a moment in every Christian's life where it supernaturally connects to where we finally get to a point where we say, oh, that's what this is about. It's not just about following a bunch of rules and doing things that I think I'm supposed to do. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ that changes my life. Jesus talked about it all throughout the Gospels. Just a couple of those places, one of them, John chapter 10, verse 10. We've heard it hundreds of times that Jesus is speaking, and he tells us a thief only comes to kill and to steal and to destroy. Look at me. That is the devil's mission statement. He hates your guts. And his mission is to destroy your life. That's what he wants to do. But then Jesus follows it up with what his purpose is, what his mission statement is, and that is that I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly, that you might have it over and above, that you might have it more than is necessary, that you might have life and have it supremely. And I would love to take the time this morning to just go around the sanctuary by show of hands and ask people who feel like they're living an abundant life. Unfortunately, I'm afraid that would be a minority. And then I have to ask myself the question, why don't more people want to be part of this? Well, because they don't see those people that are living over the top. They don't see those people that are living more abundantly. And so it doesn't connect with them because they're going through that now. Again, in Luke 24, Jesus, after the resurrection, he's walking down the road. The Bible tells us that there's a couple of believers that are walking with him. They believe in Jesus. They're walking with him. They're studying the scriptures. They're talking about the Bible with him, the scriptures. But we're told in Luke 24, verse 31, that suddenly, say it, suddenly. Can you do it without like the Appalachian drawl? Just say, suddenly. Thank you. It says, suddenly their eyes were opened and they recognized him. There's a moment in time in the life and the journey of every Christian where this supernaturally connects to where we come to a point where we realize this is not about duty and obligation. It's about coming and celebrating Jesus. It's about living my life in such a way to make Jesus smile. In these last couple of weeks, I've been asked several times by several people, do you think this is it? Do you think this is the end? We had the earthquake in Taiwan. We had the earthquake on the East Coast. Then we got Israel under attack now, and we got all these things. We had the tornadoes. And here's my answer. I don't know. And you should be thankful that I'm saying I don't know. Because if I said I know, you should probably run. Because nobody knows, right? I don't know, but I do know this. I want to wake up every day and live my life in such a way to make Jesus smile. And I guarantee you this, I may not have all the eschatological things in my brain. That's the study of end times. All the end time stuff in my brain. But I can promise you this. I guarantee you this. If you wake up every day and live your life in such a way to make Jesus smile, you're going to make it. You'll get there. Whenever it happens. These men were believers. They were discussing the scriptures with Jesus. But the Bible tells us suddenly they recognized him. I don't know if that seems odd to you. It seems odd to me. There was a sudden change. They had heard of Jesus, but suddenly they saw Jesus. What about Luke chapter 15? Story of the prodigal. And we're going to go back here in just a few minutes, but just to get this opening out of the way, there's the son that's looking for the inheritance. He leaves early, right? He never quit believing in the Father. But he wasn't connected like he needed to be. And we're told in Luke 15, verse 17, that while he's in that pig pen, he finally came to his senses. He finally came to an understanding. And maybe my favorite biblical moment, not my favorite biblical verse necessarily, but my favorite biblical moment can be found in Matthew chapter 16, starting at verse 13. It says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, plural, right, a bunch of them, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Now, he gave them the answer in the question, didn't he? Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Well, they, the disciples, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But then he said, but who do you say? I think this might be a supernatural divine moment for some people. We all know who Jesus is, but who do you say that he is? Who do you really say that he is in your living? And then verse 16 tells us, Simon Peter answered and said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus speaks to Simon and says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. He said, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for you did not learn this in a spiritual warfare conference. Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, because you didn't learn this from a book that you read. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because you didn't learn this from someone just telling you that. He said, my Father, which is in heaven, had a divine encounter with you. And suddenly this connected. Suddenly this made sense. And you understand that I am the Christ, Son of the living God. Matter of fact, St. Irenaeus, who was born just 100 years within the time that Jesus was on the earth, he is credited with this saying, the glory of God is man fully alive. The glory of God is human beings fully alive. Again, I would love to just go around the sanctuary and just ask the question, who feels like you're fully alive? But the truth of the matter is, life should be more than abundant, because that's what Jesus came to give us. We need a sudden recognition of who he is, just like the two that were walking on the road to Emmaus, and then we need to come to our senses. I think this can describe someone who is fully alive. Fully alive. We know who Jesus is. And because we know who Jesus is, our life is abundant. No matter what we see, no matter what we feel, no matter what we're being told, our life is more abundant. And some of you that have been around for a while, you know, for years I've called this the aha moment. It's that moment where suddenly it just connects. It's not about duty and obligation. It's about relationship and making Jesus smile. As a matter of fact, Wikipedia has a definition of the aha moment. Here's what Wikipedia says. It's the common human experience of suddenly understanding a previously incomprehensible problem or concept. That's a mouthful. Incomprehensible concept. What is it about the Christian experience that seems incomprehensible to you? Is it the grace? Surely God's grace is not enough to cover someone who's done things worse than me. Is it that I don't understand the grace? Is it I don't understand his mercy? I don't understand the joy of the Lord that I can rejoice, but the only way I can rejoice is if I rejoiced in the first place? What is the incomprehensible concept to you? And so I reduce this down to a definition of aha. It's a God-given moment that changes everything. It's just a God-given moment that changes everything. And so I want to spend a few weeks. This is not the first time we've gone down this path. We used this message before, but after Chris spoke last week, my heart was stirred, and I just felt like we need to go back and revisit this. But I want to talk to us about, do you get it? Do you get it? The aha moment. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for today. Thank you for your awesomeness. I pray this morning that our eyes can be opened, our lives can be changed, and we can have that sudden awareness of who you are that changes us forever. God, give us this morning the aha moment. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for that. We ask it all in Christ's name. Someone say amen. You go into any bookstore, the largest section in the bookstore is self-help. The self-help section. A comedian was once quoted by saying that he'd went into a bookstore and asked the saleswoman, where is the self-help section? She answered and said, if she told me, it would defeat the purpose. You can spend hours in the self-help section of the bookstore. There's so many books there. Here's a couple of titles that I found. How to Make People Like You in 90 Seconds or Less. Some of you need to read that. Becoming a Better You. Influence, the Psychology of Persuasion. How to Get Millions of Idiots to Buy Your Book. I mean, let's just think about this for a moment. If one of those books really worked, the others would not be necessary. If one of those books actually did the job, the others would not be necessary, yet these books are everywhere. Can I tell you that last year, worldwide, it's a $13 billion industry. The self-help industry, $13 billion with 45,000 books printed about self-help. Not only that, but there are 71,000 self-help coaches that you can hire for between $75 to $200 an hour. That's another $1 billion that you can add to the 13 of this industry. And despite all of these fix-it guides, most of us would readily admit, I need help. We may not admit it out loud. We may not want anybody to know that. But the truth of the matter is, we would all admit, I need help. And we look at all these labels of some of the most important sections of the bookstore, and you find that self-help section, and in that section you find all these books that are going to try to change your life, and it's making a lot of people a lot of money. And I've just stopped by this morning to save you some money. That ought to get some of your ears to perk up. I've stopped by to save you some money. You don't need to spend $13 billion on self-help, because you don't need self-help. You need God's help. That's what we need. We need God's help, because He's the one who'll change us forever. You're talking about improving your marriage or getting control of your finances or starting that diet that's finally going to knock off those 40 pounds that you need to lose. Overcoming your addictions, managing my stress. I mean, they're all in there. The truth is, we already have instruction. And it's been my experience. I don't know about you. It's been my experience. It seems like all these self-help authors went to the same self-help writing school. They all use the same formula. It goes like this. Pick a number between, you know, follow our, pick a number between 1 and 8, easy steps, and we guarantee that you will insert your goal, whatever it is, financial gain, weight control, goal, whatever, and only a matter of put another number in there and another measure of time. For example, follow our 8 steps, and we guarantee you will find financial gain in only a matter of 3 months. They all use the same formula. And it's making them a lot of money. And too often what we do is we run to these merry-go-rounds thinking that they're going to help us, expecting that somehow, some way, we're going to have a better life. We know something's wrong. We admit that we need help. We know we need to change. But the truth of the matter is we don't really want to change that much that we'll do something about it. And the Lord wants to help us with that. Because if self-help could do it, we would have all been fixed a long, long time ago. So what we need to do is be aware of the relationship with Jesus Christ is what will change our life. This sermon, maybe these couple of sermons, they're not going to be self-help for us. If we look at them that way, that's not going to change our life. It's not going to help us through the process. What we need to do is have that moment where suddenly this connects. Suddenly this makes sense. As a matter of fact, this would be the antithesis to self-help. This would be the opposite of self-help. This is us saying, God, we need your help. And what it needs to start with, before we get any further, what it needs to start with is a rejection of who you are. See, sometimes we see ourselves and we think it's okay. And because we think it's okay, then we just continue to do what we've always done and we always get what we've always gotten. And we need to accept that we look in the mirror and not forget what we look like. But look in the mirror of God's Word and let it change us. So how will this change us? Well, I hope that there's a sudden recognition that will lead to this honest moment that brings us to lasting change. And that's been my prayer ever since, really since last week, but even before that. Lord, change me, transform me, so that I can live my life in such a way that's going to make you smile. How Thurman said, don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive and go do it. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive. Come alive. And for us to get where we're going, we've got to admit where we're at. Whether you're at the mall or an amusement park and you're kind of lost and you want to know how to get to a certain place, you go to that big map and what's the first thing you look for? You are here. Right? You don't look for where you're going. You want to find out where you're at so you can know how to get where you're going. You have to recognize where you're at before you can get where you're going. And if we're going to have that moment, that supernatural moment where this connects, we have that God-given moment that changes everything. We have to know where we're at. We have to admit where we're at. We have to realize that you are here. Where is here? Where is here in your life? And so to kind of understand that, let's go back to Luke 15. Let's go back to the story of the prodigal son. Jesus is talking, and to illustrate the point further, look at me. It starts out to illustrate the point further. If you look earlier in Luke 15, you see the parables of the lost sheep and the lost coin. So what Jesus is talking about is lost and found. He's talking about things that were lost that are now found. And to further illustrate that point, he goes into another parable. Jesus tells him this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, younger son packed all of his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all of his money in wild living. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. Verse 15, he persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding to the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. So sad how wild living makes something bad look good. Oh, it looks good, but it's not good. Verse 17. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, look at me for just a minute. Sometimes it's okay to talk to yourself. I don't recommend you do it in the middle of your workplace, but sometimes you've got to talk to yourself. That's what this guy did. He finally came to his senses, and then he's going to say to himself, it reminded me of King David before he was king. He's being hunted by Saul. He's being haunted by Saul. And in Psalm 103, we read, I will bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me, bless his holy name. That's David talking to himself. That's David saying, I will bless the Lord. David's walking down the road, and he's saying to himself, I will bless the Lord. Listen, sometimes in the middle of your tribulation and sometimes in the middle of your trial, what you've got to do is talk to yourself. You've got to tell yourself, I will bless the Lord. This is not going to change my eternity. No matter what's going on, no matter whether it's physical, spiritual, financial, emotional, no matter what's going on, it doesn't change eternity. God is still on the throne. And sometimes we have to talk to ourselves to understand that. And that's what this guy's doing. He said, I'm going to talk to myself. And the prodigal said this, I'm going to go home. And I'm going to say, even the hired servants have food enough to spare. And here I am dying of hunger. I'm going to go to my father. And this is what I'm going to say. I've sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant. He talks to himself all the way home, rehearsing this speech. Verse 20, so he returned home to his father, and while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. Now, my daughter sent me a little reel this morning or yesterday that a pastor illustrated this part, but I'm not going to do that right now, okay? He brought his son up out of the, my son wouldn't, he wouldn't even come up here, but he brought his son up and acted like, you know, that was the prodigal, and he hugged him and kissed him and everything, and nobody in my family is that way, so I can't even bring Vicky up here and do that. So if you can just imagine with me, that here's a father who's, he must have been looking for the son. Man, who needs to hear that? You think you've gone too far? Nope, he's still looking for you. And it's believed, and I'm going to kind of give you a quick scripture to kind of prove the point, but tradition during this time was that if a son did what this guy did and he returned home, the neighbors would stone him. I'm not so sure that's a bad thing. Maybe we should bring it back. Deuteronomy chapter 18, I'm just going to read it to you, verses 18 through 21. If a man has a stubborn and rebellious son who will not obey the voice of his father or the voice of his mother, and who when they have chastened him will not heed them, then his father and his mother shall take hold of him and bring him out to the elders of the city, to the gate of the city, and they shall say to the elders of the city, this son of ours is a stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. He's a glutton and a drunkard. Then all the men of his city shall stone him to death with stones. So you shall put away evil from among you, and all Israel shall hear and fear. You get the point? The son did what this son did, and he's coming back to the father. The reason the father keeps looking for him is because he don't want the neighbors to throw stones at him. The reason he goes and embraces him and hugs him is because if the neighbor does throw a stone, the father's going to take the hit. Somebody, please hear me this morning. You cannot go that far away from God that he won't run after you. He's looking for you. He's watching for you, just like this father did. Verse 21, here's what the son said. He'd been practicing, right? He'd been rehearsing this speech all the way home. Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you, no longer worthy to be called your son. But his father said to the servants, quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring, put it on his finger. Sandals for his feet. kill the calf that we've been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast because this son who took half of what I had and left our home and squandered it in another country, in a distant country, because this son of mine who was dead has now returned to life. Remember, Christianity is not about making bad people good or good people better. It's about bringing dead people back to life. This son of mine that was dead is now alive. He's returned to life. He was lost, but now he's found. So the party began. Suddenly, he came to his senses. That's what I want to talk to us before we pray this morning. When we need to wake up, when we need that moment, when we need to suddenly arise, what do? We set an alarm. If you want to get up at a certain time, you set the alarm. You might get up before the alarm goes off, but you still set the alarm because you know you got to get up at a certain time. And here's what I've discovered. The effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation of how much we don't want to hear it. I'm going to let that sink in for a minute. The effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. Some of you, even now, as I'm sharing this, you don't want to hear it. But God might be setting an alarm in your life, and you need to hear it, whether you're in this sanctuary, whether you're watching this by Facebook. Because an alarm is not just in your bedroom to tell you when it's time to get up. There are alarms in our life as well. And sometimes we just don't pay any attention to them because the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. Well, you don't understand, Pastor Terry. I'm lonely. You don't understand, Pastor Terry. I just don't have enough money. You don't understand. Listen, I don't have to understand. What I do understand is the alarm's effectiveness is in direct correlation of how much we don't want to hear it. For example, a wife in her mid-30s returns home after meeting up with her high school sweetheart. She'd reconnected with him on Facebook. She'd been friending a bunch of people that she went to school with. And one day she checks her page, and this guy had posted to say hi. Through private messages, they relived some old memories. Eventually, one of them suggested they meet up. So they met in the lobby of a hotel. When he first walked in, she felt this flurry of emotions. They ate lunch together. He was still charming, funny. At one point, passed the salt to her and their hands brushed against each other. Her heart beat furiously as though she was a schoolgirl again. And then suddenly, she felt alive. She left, went home, walked in the door, bumped into the table. Family picture falls over on its face. She grabs the picture, picks it up, stops for a minute, sees her and her husband and the kids as they're all making silly faces for the camera. The alarm sounds. And the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much I don't want to hear it. College students' grades came in the mail. His partying has resulted in him flunking out of school. The alarm goes off. She's just a junior in high school with trembling hands as she holds the pregnancy test. She waits for the results. The alarm had gone off. He logged off the website, deleted the history, turned off the computer while his wife slept in the other room. But he's chosen this over her. The alarm goes off. Sooner or later, listen to me, sooner or later in the distant country, the alarm will sound. And the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. Who are you, Pastor Terry, to tell me what's wrong with my life? Who are you, God, to tell me what's wrong with my life? The son in this story, the prodigal son, did not heed the alarm until he was in the pig pen. I wonder how many times that the alarm might have gone off before in his life, but the effectiveness, I don't know if I've said this yet or not, but the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. He waits till he's in the pig pen, not when he made the request from the father for his share of the inheritance. That's not what, he didn't pay attention to it then. He didn't even pay attention to it a few weekends later when his wallet felt lighter. His money's beginning to dry up and he still doesn't hear it. He doesn't hear it when famine sweeps through the land. He didn't hear it when he took the job of pig sitter. How did he not hear the alarm? And how many of us ask ourselves the same question? How did I not hear the alarm? How did I end up here? How come I did not hear the alarm? How could I have slept through that? Sometimes it's because we're not sensitive to the alarm, but sometimes it's because we keep hitting the snooze button. Vicky's not in here right now, so I can talk about her. My wife has 35 alarms on her phone. 35 or more, maybe more than that. And we'll be sitting together in the living room. That alarm goes off and it's so loud. So loud. And she hits snooze. Guess what happens 8 minutes later? It goes off again. The 15th time it goes off, I say, why don't you just do what you set the alarm to do? Just get up and do that. That way you don't have to keep hitting snooze. It's our life. That's what we do. How did the prodigal not hear the alarm? Or did he just keep hitting the snooze button? But here's what I can promise you. Eventually, it's going to be so loud you can't ignore it. And then you're going to wonder, how did I get here? How did this happen? How did my life end up in this place? And I have to throw the question out to all of us right now. Is the alarm sounding in your life in this moment, right now? Sometimes we think that we have to hit rock bottom before we can hear the alarm, but that's not true. God might be trying to wake some of us up right now, right this moment. We don't have to be in a distant country. Not if we hear the alarm that God has put in our life. There's an alarm in all of us, but the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. You see, sometimes it's God's word that's just at the right time. I have no doubt people sitting in this sanctuary watching us by Facebook right now the Lord is sending an alarm in your life, and he's done it through the word. He's done it through this story of the prodigal. But the effectiveness of that alarm is in direct correlation to how much you don't want to hear it. Sometimes it's through his word. Sometimes he will send an alarm through a friend. Proverbs 27, verse 5 and 6. Open rebuke is better than love carefully concealed. Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of the enemy are deceitful. Deceitful. Some of us need a friend in our life that will just look at us and say, listen, stop it. Just quit. Get that person out of your life. Get that place out of your life. Just stop it. And we need that friend that can say that to us and we not get offended about it. Well, you're just not my friend no more. What are you, in high school? Sometimes it's through the word. Sometimes it's through a friend. And we all need friends like that from time to time that will stop us and look at us and say, hey, listen, you're neglecting your family. You're putting this over the importance of your family. Stop it. We need someone to look at us and say, listen, your spending is out of control. And I'd like to camp there for a while. We need a friend that will challenge us to come to church more than just a couple times a month. It's not about coming because I have to. Coming because I get to. And we get to hang out together. We get to worship God together. Praise, giving praise, giving praise. Man, that was a good one. I like that. No matter what the circumstances might be, no matter what the situation looks like, you and I are too driven by what we can see and what we can feel. Instead of just saying, okay, God, you're in charge. We need a friend that will get in our face and question that relationship that you're starting. I'm just going to let it set in. An alarm can come from God's word. It can come from a friend. Sometimes it'll come from future consequences. That fender bender in the parking lot can keep you from a 10-car pileup down the road. God will send us alarms, but the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. There are things in some of our lives that we should have put away long ago. Long ago. But we haven't. And because we haven't, it sometimes prevents us from that supernatural moment that this connects. And suddenly this makes sense. And suddenly there's that aha moment, that God-given moment that changes everything. I realize I'm an old man. I got it. I heard Dave tell me I was so old this morning because I have no hair, I'm gray, I'm tall, whatever those kids said. Them kids. God didn't call me to that ministry. I know, listen, I know I'm old, but there was a time in my life where I was just, I was an awful person, an awful person. But there was a better time in my life where this made sense. This made sense. This suddenly connected to where it's not about obligation and duty, it's about relationship and making Jesus smile. It's about knowing Him and making Him known. And sometimes we just need that alarm to go off. Sometimes it's through the Word. Sometimes it's through a song. Sometimes through a devotional. Sometimes it's by a friend. Sometimes it's because of future consequences. But sometimes we just need to ask ourselves the question, where is this going? This thing that I've entered into, whether it's a relationship, whether it's an addiction, whether it's a habit, whatever it is, where is this leading me to? What happened to other people who have done the same thing? Can I learn from them? Or do I need to learn these lessons myself? Because their experience can be a warning to us, can be an alarm to us, but we have to be willing to hear it. If you're going to go down this path, it's going to end up in the same place as somebody else, and you need to learn from that. Raising my children, I tell them not to do certain things. They say, well, you did it. Anybody else's kids tell you that? You did it. Don't do as I do as I say. I'm telling you, I learned from that. I learned how bad that was. Don't do it. And they did it anyway. What alarm is going off in your life and in my life right now? Right in this moment. I'm not talking about next week or last week. I'm talking about right now. You know what it is. You've sensed it. You've felt it. What is it? And what do you do about it? Linda, if you'll come. Let me close with this story. There's a story in 2 Kings in the Old Testament where the king of Aram is an enemy to the nation of Israel. And he sends a huge army to take care of the prophet Elisha. King of Aram doesn't like Israel. And so he sends a huge army to take out Israel's prophet at that time, Elisha. And geographically, Elisha and his servant are kind of like in a bowl. It's just mountain range all the way around. And the king of Aram has sent his army, which lines the whole rim of this canyon. And Elisha's servant looks at Elisha, the prophet of God, and says, Master, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And here's Elisha's response in 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 16. He looks at his servant. He says, don't be afraid, because those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Now, pause for just a second. Elisha's servant sees this great army. He doesn't see what Elisha sees. Elisha sees the army of God. And he tells the servant, listen, don't be afraid. We got a bigger army than they do. The servant no doubt looks at Elisha and thinks, you have lost your mind. You don't even know what you're talking about. Look, I mean, look. Listen, this next part is what's so crucial. The servant looks at Elisha. What are we going to do? Elisha says, don't be afraid. And then Elisha prays this prayer, and here's what I pray for us. He said, open his eyes, Lord, that he may see. Once I heard about you, now I see you. This servant has traveled with Elisha all this time. I'm sure he's heard about some great things. But when Elisha prays this prayer for the servant's eyes to be opened, he went from hearing to seeing. And we're told, then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. His eyes were opened, and aha, the moment, the God moment that changed everything. The God moment that connected him supernaturally to what his journey was all about. And that's my prayer for us. God, give us that moment that changes everything. I know it probably sounds like hyperbole and trying to play on different emotions and stuff. Listen, there's no reason why every church in Lawrence County, Ohio shouldn't be busting at the seams. No reason. No reason. Except we have people that are just trudging along this journey called Christianity instead of living the life that is more abundant. And the way we live the life that's more abundant is we have that moment where this connects, where this makes sense. It's not just about doing things. It's about being someone. It's about being who God wants us to be. How does that happen? When I let him have it all. When I recognize who he is, and I come to an honest moment with myself that changes everything. Stand with me. Lord, thank you this morning for who you are and the incredible stuff you do for us. Far exceeds anything that we could ever imagine or think of you to do. Lord, I thank you for that moment in time where this makes sense. That moment in time where this connects. That moment in time that changes our life forever. Well, I pray the same prayer. Open our eyes so that we might see. Open our eyes that we might see. I love you, Lord. I thank you in Christ's name. Keep your heads bowed for just a moment. If you're here this morning and you're not in a right relationship with Christ, you need an aha moment. You need that divine moment where God reveals himself to you. You need that moment that will change the trajectory of your life forever. But it takes an honest moment, an honest decision on your part, an honest recognition of where you're at to know where you want to go. And so I'm going to ask the praise team to sing this chorus through just a couple of times. If you're here this morning, you're not in a right relationship with Christ, but you want to be, I would love to pray with you. But that decision is yours. So if that's you this morning, as they sing, would you come? Just let me pray with you this morning.
Amazing grace.
have one more prayer together. Man, this is awesome. And I might be old, but I got up and down them steps 3 times. With a torn meniscus. Woo! Maybe the Lord's healed me. I don't know. I'm feeling good. Maybe go running after a while. I wonder who might be here this morning that the alarm is going off. You know what I'm talking about. That alarm's going off. And the effectiveness of the alarm is in direct correlation to how much we don't want to hear it. But how many that alarm is going off, you do want to hear it. I just want you to come to this altar area. Nobody needs to know what's going on. It's between you and God. I just want you to be bold enough and brave enough just to walk to this altar area, and we'll have a final prayer together. The alarm's going off. You want to respond? Come to the altar. Let's sing it one last time.
My chains are.
Open our eyes, Lord God, that we might see that those who are for us are greater than those who are against us, and we just need to walk in the promises of the Almighty. God, we need to have that sudden recognition that changes our life. And so, God, for these who have responded this morning, myself included, God, let us hear and respond to that alarm. And let us do it in such a way, Lord God, that brings a smile to your face. God, whatever the circumstance is, whatever the situation is in each of these lives, I know that you are greater. And so we just lean on you, we trust in you, we hope in you, and our faith is in you, that you will help us, Lord God, as we take that next step, and let that next step be a step that just draws us closer to you. God, we love you, we praise you, we bless you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Those of you that respond, look at me for just a moment. It's really up to us, right? We're free moral agents. We get to do whatever we want to do whenever we want to do it. But that alarm clock going off inside of us, we have a choice to make. And that is a choice to do the right thing instead of the wrong thing. We all can do it. We just need God's help to do it. And I believe he's going to help us with that. And I expect to just hear some great testimonies because of this morning and because of how great God is. I love you guys. And I need us to make good decisions and do the right things. Amen? Amen. I love you. God bless you. Tonight at 6 o'clock, our men's meeting. We'll see you then.